Imagine a land where freedom wasn't just a dream, but a fierce and unyielding reality. Welcome to 1728 Jamaica, where the battle for liberty ignites with the arrival of more British troops, altering the delicate balance of power with the Windward Maroons. In September 1728, the landscape of Jamaica shifted dramatically as the British reinforced their presence by dispatching additional troops. This strategic move was aimed at altering the delicate balance of power that existed between the colonial forces and the formidable Windward Maroons. The British, determined to quash the Maroon resistance, appointed a new governor, Major General Robert Hunter, whose tenure marked a significant escalation in the conflict. Hunter arrived with a reputation for his military prowess and a clear mandate to bring the Maroons to heel. His arrival was not just a change in leadership, but a declaration of intensified hostilities. The British forces, now bolstered, began to implement more aggressive strategies, hoping to overpower the Maroon fighters who had long been a thorn in their side. Among the Maroons, one leader stood out for his bravery and tactical genius, Captain Jeddo. Celebrated by the Maroons of Moortown and chronicled by Maroon historian Bev Carey, Jeddo was a lieutenant of the legendary Nanny, herself a symbol of Maroon resistance. In 1729, a year after Hunter's arrival, Jeddo orchestrated a daring attack on the northeastern town of Port Antonio. This bold move was more than just a raid. It was a statement of defiance against the British encroachment. The attack on Port Antonio was meticulously planned. Jeddo and his warriors used their intimate knowledge of the terrain to their advantage, executing a surprise assault that left the British forces reeling. Lieutenant Soper, leading the British soldiers, underestimated the Maroons' capability and resolve. As Soper and his men attempted to regroup and pursue the Maroons into the dense, unfamiliar forest, they found themselves ambushed. The Maroons, utilizing guerrilla tactics, capitalized on their home ground advantage, catching the British off guard and inflicting significant casualties. Jeddo's leadership during this attack exemplified the Maroons' strategic acumen and their unwavering commitment to their autonomy. His actions not only boosted the morale of his fellow Maroons, but also served as a stark reminder to the British that the Maroons were a force to be reckoned with. The skirmish at Port Antonio was a prelude to the many battles that would follow, each underscoring the fierce resistance of the Maroons and the escalating conflict that defined Major General Hunter's governorship. This encounter was a pivotal moment in the First Maroon War, setting the stage for the prolonged struggle between the British and the Maroons. The bravery of leaders like Jeddo and the relentless spirit of the Maroon fighters would continue to shape the course of Jamaica's history, highlighting the resilience and ingenuity of those who fought for their freedom against overwhelming odds. During the First Maroon War, the Maroons mastered the art of guerrilla warfare, leveraging their deep knowledge of Jamaica's rugged terrain to launch surprise attacks and ambushes. These tactics proved highly effective, causing significant losses for the colonial militias, not only in manpower, but also in financial resources. The dense forests and mountainous regions provided the perfect cover for the Maroons, allowing them to strike swiftly and then vanish, leaving the British forces struggling to mount an effective defense. In 1730, Lieutenant Soper, determined to crush the Maroon resistance, led a substantial force against the Windward Maroons. However, the Maroons, under the brilliant leadership of Nanny and Quao, were prepared. Nanny, a formidable strategist, utilized her warriors' intimate knowledge of the land to orchestrate ambushes that decimated Soper's troops. Quao, a skilled commander, coordinated attacks that disrupted the British supply lines and communication, further weakening their resolve. Despite the British military's superior numbers and weaponry, they found themselves consistently outmaneuvered by the agile and elusive Maroons. The defeat of Soper's force was a testament to the Maroons' tactical prowess and their unyielding determination to defend their freedom. The following year, recognizing the need for more substantial reinforcements, the British dispatched two additional regiments to Jamaica. These new troops were meant to bolster Major General Robert Hunter's campaign against the Maroons. However, the arrival of these reinforcements also highlighted the escalating cost and difficulty of the conflict. Each new regiment brought with it a greater financial burden, and the ongoing war continued to drain the colony's resources. Despite these reinforcements, the Maroons remained undeterred. Their guerrilla tactics, combined with their resolve and intimate understanding of the terrain, continued to frustrate and challenge the British forces. The Maroons' ability to sustain their resistance against increasing odds showcased their exceptional resilience and strategic ingenuity, marking them as a formidable opponent in the protracted struggle for control of Jamaica. In 1732, Major General Robert Hunter, determined to crush the Maroon resistance, dispatched three separate military parties against the Windward Maroons. This coordinated effort culminated in the occupation of Nanny Town, a significant stronghold for the Maroons. The British forces, confident in their temporary victory, took control of the town as the Maroons, under the strategic guidance of Nanny, strategically retreated deeper into the impenetrable Blue Mountains. The occupation of Nanny Town, however, proved to be a costly endeavor for the British. The logistical challenges of maintaining a military presence in such a remote and rugged area strained their resources. The expenses associated with the occupation soon became untenable, forcing Hunter to make a difficult decision. Recognizing the unsustainable nature of the occupation, he eventually ordered the recall of the militia. This withdrawal allowed the Maroons to retake Nanny Town without engaging in direct combat, a testament to their patience and strategic acumen. The following year, undeterred by the previous setbacks, Hunter sought to reassert British dominance. He sent a contingent of British seamen to engage the Windward Maroons. The seamen, likely unaccustomed to the guerrilla tactics and harsh terrain that the Maroons navigated with ease, found themselves at a severe disadvantage. The Maroons, utilizing their knowledge of the landscape and their mastery of unconventional warfare, launched a series of ambushes and hit-and-run attacks. The British seamen, despite their naval training and discipline, were unprepared for the Maroons' relentless and unpredictable assaults. The Maroons' ability to strike swiftly and then disappear into the dense foliage left the British forces disoriented and demoralized. The seamen's defeat was yet another victory for the Maroons, further solidifying their reputation as formidable warriors. These events underscored the immense challenges the British faced in their attempts to subdue the Maroons. The Maroons' strategic retreats, combined with their effective use of guerrilla tactics, continued to frustrate and exhaust the British forces. Each engagement not only demonstrated the Maroons' resilience and tactical brilliance, but also highlighted the growing cost and futility of the British campaign to dominate Jamaica. In 1734, the Windward Maroons engaged in fierce battles against the British forces in Portland Parish and St. George. These confrontations were part of the ongoing struggle for control and autonomy that defined the First Maroon War. The Maroons, skilled in guerrilla tactics and intimately familiar with the terrain, fought valiantly to protect their communities and way of life. As the conflict raged, enslaved Africans across Jamaica seized the opportunity to escape their bondage. Many fled from the plantations and deserted the Blackshot support forces, which were composed of black soldiers fighting for the British. These deserters sought refuge with the Maroons, bolstering their numbers and adding to the growing resistance against the British colonial forces. During this turbulent period, Major General Robert Hunter, who had been leading the British efforts against the Maroons, died. He was succeeded by John Ayscough, who inherited the daunting task of quelling the Maroon resistance. Despite his best efforts, Ayscough faced the same challenges as his predecessor. The Maroons' tactical expertise and the harsh, mountainous terrain continued to thwart British advances, leading to limited success for Ayscough in his campaign. That same year, the British militia managed to recapture Nanny Town, a key Maroon stronghold. This temporary victory was a significant blow to the Maroons, as Nanny Town had been a symbol of their resistance and independence. However, the occupation of Nanny Town proved to be costly and difficult to maintain, as the Maroons continued their relentless guerrilla warfare. Despite the recapture of Nanny Town, the British forces struggled to secure a decisive victory. The Maroons' resilience and ability to adapt to the changing circumstances of the war ensured that their fight for freedom would persist. The events of 1734 highlighted the enduring spirit of the Maroon warriors and the ongoing challenge the British faced in their efforts to dominate Jamaica. In 1734, the Windward Maroons, under the legendary leadership of Nanny, achieved a significant victory against a British force commanded by Captain Shettlewood. This triumph was not merely a tactical success. It was a symbolic assertion of the Maroons' resilience and strategic ingenuity. Nanny's leadership during this engagement further cemented her status as a formidable figure in the struggle for Maroon independence. During this period, a group of liberated Africans, seizing the momentum of the Maroon victories, launched an audacious assault on an estate in St. George. This estate was well fortified, complete with a fort and barracks, but the liberated Africans, driven by a desire for freedom and autonomy, managed to conquer it. This victory was a significant morale booster for the Maroon forces and their allies, showcasing their ability to strike at the heart of colonial power structures. Following these victories, the Windward Maroons strategically relocated westwards to the John Crow Mountains, settling in an area known as Cattawoods, or Cattawood Springs. This move was a calculated effort to fortify their position and continue their resistance from a more secure and defensible location. The John Crow Mountains, with their rugged terrain and dense forests, provided an ideal refuge for the Maroons, allowing them to launch further guerrilla operations against the British. The prolonged conflict had severe repercussions for colonial Jamaica. The relentless Maroon resistance, combined with the broader implications of the war, led to significant economic and demographic shifts. By the end of 1734, the island's white population had dwindled to approximately 2,000, reflecting the toll that the ongoing strife had taken. Additionally, sugar exports, a cornerstone of the island's economy, had plummeted, exacerbating the financial strain on the colony. The persistent state of unrest also led to periods of martial law, as the colonial authorities struggled to maintain order and control. These measures, however, only underscored the desperation and challenges faced by the British in their attempts to subdue the Maroon fighters. The Maroons' ability to sustain their resistance and adapt to changing circumstances demonstrated their unyielding commitment to their cause. By 1734, it was clear that the conflict between the Maroons and the British was not just a series of skirmishes, but a protracted war that would have lasting impacts on the island's social and economic fabric. The Maroons' victories and their strategic relocations underscored their resilience and tactical brilliance, setting the stage for the continued struggle for freedom and autonomy in Jamaica. In 1735, the Leeward Maroons, under the bold leadership of Cudjoe, orchestrated a daring assault that resulted in the capture of military barracks in western Jamaica. This audacious move demonstrated the strategic prowess and bravery of the Maroon warriors, further undermining British control and emboldening the Maroon resistance. Cudjoe's leadership was instrumental in these efforts, showcasing his ability to inspire and direct his fighters in complex military operations. During this tumultuous period, Governor John Asco passed away while still in office, leaving a significant power vacuum in the British colonial administration. His successor, John Gregory, was immediately thrust into a challenging situation as he assumed the governorship. Gregory's primary concern was the persistent and escalating Maroon attacks, which were destabilizing the colony and draining its resources. The assaults on Titchfield Fort were not just acts of retaliation, but part of a broader strategy to weaken British military infrastructure and disrupt their operations. The Windward Maroons, leveraging their knowledge of the terrain and their expertise in guerrilla tactics, managed to inflict significant damage and casualties on the British forces stationed there. These actions further strained the resources of the colonial administration and highlighted the growing difficulties they faced in maintaining control over the island. The capture of the military barracks by Cudjoe and his warriors was a significant blow to British morale and a stark reminder of the Maroons' capabilities. In response to the British militia's earlier occupation of Nanny Town, the Windward Maroons, driven by a desire for retribution and strategic advantage, launched a series of assaults on Titchfield Fort in Port Antonio. These attacks were well-coordinated and relentless, aimed at undermining British defenses and asserting Maroon dominance in the region. Governor Gregory, recognizing the severity of the situation, had to quickly devise new strategies to counter the Maroon threat. However, the ongoing conflict and the Maroons' continued successes demonstrated the challenges the British faced in their efforts to subdue the resilient and determined Maroon fighters. The events of 1735 underscored the Maroons' unwavering resolve to defend their autonomy and the significant impact their resistance had on the colonial power structure in Jamaica.